In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, amen. So before we start our sermon, let's just continue where we left off in terms of the explanation of the liturgy. So as a reminder, if we miss any of these, just go to that basically icon on our website under all the video archives, and you'll see all the ones that we've made. I think we're up to about 22 right now. So quick recap. We said that everything starts with preparation, right? So that's our Vespers and our Matins. That's our preparation. And even if we can't attend, we should do everything we can to prepare for this holy day. So Saturday evenings, any time before the liturgy, we should work towards the preparation. We talked about all the rites and all the things that we do in terms of that. After the preparation or after the Matins, we have the offering, where the priest, when we basically showed you what the criteria is to pick the bread to become the Lamb of God. And then we have the burial, as you just saw minutes ago. Now we are in the third part, or like again, maybe the third part, which is basically the liturgy of the word. And we said this is the part where we receive the word of God. We receive the word of God, like sacramentally. And that's why we put very high importance on not missing one word that is being read. And we talked about all the different readings. So we consider this as our first communion with God, because we are having union with him through his word. And then we talked about all the things that are happening from the very beginning, the hymn of the censer, and that's exactly when, as the deacons are doing that, the priest is going all around the church, the great, he does the three circuits, right? The altar circuit, the cross circuit, and the big circuit. If you don't know what these are, again, go back to the Vespers one, and we explain all three circuits, what we do. We have the epistle readers from St. Paul, and the Catholic epistle from one of the general epistles. And then we have the book of Acts, which shows kind of like the action part, like the practical aspects of whatever readings. And then we have the story of the saint, the saint of the day. And every day has a story. Every day has a saint. Today it was those two martyrs. And then we have the litany of the gospel. So everyone, so let me go finish off the reading. So what we talked about last week is those silent prayers that the priest prays at the same time. Like, for example, to purify us, to cleanse us, to take away all the stench of sin, the power that sin has upon us. This is what we're praying for. We're praying, hey, let these people not wander, especially last week, right? And let them not think about Turkey right now. Let them think about what St. James or St. Paul or whoever is reading. So we do something similar for the litany, for the gospel. So for the gospel, it's a little bit different because all of a sudden we do have certain priorities in our readings. And the gospels, the four gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, anytime we read these, we stand. If you noticed, all the other readings, we sit. It's not like it's less important. It's just, again, this is the life and the words of Christ himself. So we stand. And then we do a litany. We pray before we read. So hopefully that reminds you a bit of last week's sermon, right? We pray before we read. And just a very small part that we say, blessed are your eyes for they see, your ears for they hear, and may be we worthy to hear and to act. So we pray, look, we want to hear, but we also want to act on whatever the gospel teaching is of the day. And at the same time, as the gospel is going on, we have another silent prayer, and I'll say this, it's a little bit long, but this is kind of like said at the same time as the gospel is being read. So here it is, but think about it. The gospel is the word of God. So it's like basically Jesus is there. He is speaking. So what's the natural thing we want to do? We want to ask him things. We want him to remember so many different things that we want. So we say the following prayer. O you who are long-suffering, abundant in mercy and true, receive our prayers and supplication. Receive our petitions, our repentance, our confession upon your holy, undefiled altar in heaven. May we be worthy to hear your holy gospels, and may we keep your precepts and your commandments and bring forth fruit. So may we hear and do, just like what we prayed. Please, let us help us do, and fruit therein 100-fold, 60-fold, 30-fold in Christ Jesus our Lord. Then we ask a whole bunch of things. We want him to remember. Remember, this is Jesus present. So please, all the sick, anybody that's sick out there, remember, O Lord, the sick among your people. You have visited them with mercy and compassion. Heal them. Remember, O Lord, our fathers and brethren who are traveling. Anybody that's traveling, we want to pray for them. Bring them back to their homes in peace and safety. Remember, Lord, the air, the heaven, the fruits of the earth, bless them. The waters of the river, bless them. The air, the heaven, the fruits of the earth, bless them. Right? All nature, all those who rely on all that, bless them. Remember, O Lord, the salvation, the healing of men and animals. Remember, O Lord, the salvation of this your holy place and every place and every monastery of our Orthodox fathers. Remember, O Lord, your leader. We pray for our leader, right? Like him or love him or hate him, doesn't matter. We need to pray for our leader. Remember, O Lord, the leader of our land, your servant. Keep him in peace, truth, and strength. So we pray for the leader. We pray for all those who are in captivity, right? Those who are in bondage, maybe it's addiction, you know? Maybe it's, unfortunately, like something like sex trafficking or something like that. Maybe it's prison. All those who are captive, whether it's their fault, anybody that's captive, by any way, remember them, save them all. Remember, Lord, our fathers and brethren who have fallen asleep and repose in the Orthodox faith, all those who have passed away, we ask him to repose their souls. Remember those who have brought unto you these gifts, those on whose behalf they have been brought, and those by whom they have been brought, give them all the heavenly reward. That should be a familiar litany to you. Remember those who suffer, all those who are suffering. Suffer hardships and affliction, distresses, save them from all their suffering. Remember, Lord, the catechumens, those who are new to the church, right? So new people coming into the church, we pray for them, to have mercy on them, to confirm their faith in you, to uproot all traces of idolatry from their hearts, your law, your fear, your commandments, your truth, and your holy precepts established in their hearts, and grant that they may know the steadfastness of the preaching which they have received, and at set time may they be worthy of the washing of the immersed for the mission of sins, as you prepare them to be a temple of your Holy Spirit. In other words, prepare them for their baptism as well. So that's the litany, and that's the gospel part. So obviously we're getting towards the end, because that's what we just did right there. So the only thing left is basically the sermon, and we have three litanies that we pray. We'll see if we have time to do them today, but I just want you to show, we'll talk about it next time, but at least maybe pray the litanies. We usually do those silently, but again, some more prayers right after the gospel. If we have time, we can do that today.